In the last lecture, we covered or we started the topic or discussion on traffic engineering, and we covered this basic part that what is the basic variables or terminologies related to a traffic stream. So mainly we discussed that its traffic volume, its speed, and its traffic density. So volume is nothing but at a particular if you consider a particular point on a highway or a road, the number of vehicles passing from that point, okay, in a given time interval, that is nothing but traffic volume. Speed is, you all know what's speed, okay, it's the distance covered by a vehicle in per unit time, so that's speed. And density is nothing but for a given stretch of road, mainly the length of the road, so how many vehicles are there in a particular stretch, so that is nothing but traffic density. And the units are given here, that the traffic volume is in vehicle per hour, the speed is in kmph, and the density is in vehicle per kilometer. That's the general units that are used. It's not like always it will be this, you can have some other units as well, like in case of volume, another type of unit that is more popular is PCU per hour. We are going to see today what is PCU. Okay. Or in case of density as well, you can have PCU per kilometer or even PCU per meter. Okay. So that's up to the stream characteristics, what is the type of the traffic stream, and depending on that, what is the way you are expressing your traffic flow, density, and speed. Right. So continuing from here, what I'll cover in short today is, now we have seen this, what is traffic volume, what is traffic speed, and what is density, but there are still some detailed types in the volume, speed, and density itself, so that we will see now. So first we'll start with the volume. So volume, it can be measured in mainly two ways, the ones mentioned here, that is average annual daily traffic, AADT, and second is average daily traffic, that is ADT. Now volume is nothing but the flow, you can say. So the traffic flow we have seen, that is number of vehicles per hour, okay. So that's the unit that we have for traffic flow or volume. So first way to measure it is, you have to do a traffic survey, and what you'll do is, you'll suppose set up a camera, video camera, at the side of a road or over the road, suppose on the street light or on a foot or bridge, and then you'll go on recording the and you'll do this for 24 hours and for 365 days, okay. So for one complete year you have set up a traffic or a video camera, and it's continuously running or recording, and it is doing so for 24 hours for 365 days, okay. And then whatever data you will get, so that will be the, what you will extract from that is number of vehicles passing through a particular point. So suppose, take the example of the figure on the left hand side. So suppose I set up a camera over here somewhere on this tree, okay, and I have fixed it, I have done all the connections in order that it will record the footage for 24 hours for 365 days. And then when I analyze the video, suppose I take this as a reference line. Okay. So what I'll do is, I'll go on counting how many number of vehicles are passing through this point, okay, in a particular time interval. So I'll set, suppose, 15 minutes or 1 hour time interval, and then I'll go on counting, and I'll do this for the entire video. Right. So whatever data then I'll get, if I convert it into vehicle per hour, so I'll be having a data of, suppose, 24 hour 365 days. So if I just multiply that 24 hours into 365 days, so it comes out to be 8760 hours. So this much data I will be having, or this much, or the data of 8760 3760 hours I'll be having. So suppose it comes out to be say 1 lakh. Okay, 1 lakh vehicle are passing in 1 year. Assume it. Okay. So what will be the AADT value, our average annual daily traffic? It will be this 1 lakh divided by the number of hours that you have. Okay. So it comes out to be roughly 11 vehicles per hour. Okay. So it's a very small amount. It's not even, I have taken just consider some arbitrary value. Okay. So this will be my flow value that I can consider. And now as we are writing it, average annual daily traffic. So I can express it in per hour, or more appropriately, I can express it in per day. So if I calculate per day, so I have to again just multiply this by 24, or rather than divided by dividing 1 lakh by 8760, I'll divide 1 lakh by 365. So I'll get roughly around 273 vehicles per day. Okay. So this will be my average annual daily traffic. Right. I hope you have understood. So I have not read the definition for you, that you can do. I have tried to explain it through an example. So average annual daily traffic is, suppose you do a survey, traffic volume count, in which you count the number of vehicles passing a particular point in a particular time interval. And now this time interval is for 24 hours up to 365 days, one complete year. And then if I analyze it and I find out per day how many vehicles are passing on an average, so that will be my AADT count, annual average annual daily traffic. So total number of vehicles that I have assumed is 1 lakh suppose, and divided by 365. Okay, because we are calculating it for a whole year, or counting it for a whole year, so that gives out 273 vehicle per day. That will be my AADT value. Okay. Now obviously, if you think over it, is it feasible to do a traffic volume count for whole year, 365 days long and 24 hour continuously? Even if you are doing it through a videography survey, then too, it's very difficult and a tedious job, because later you have to analyze that video also. So who will sit and analyze the whole 8760 hours video? Okay, so it's almost, I'll not say impossible, but it's very time consuming, it's expensive, and it takes a lot of resources. So what we do is, instead of doing this annual average daily traffic, or doing this survey for 365 days, we cut it short. Okay. So there comes our second type of volume measurement, that is ADT, okay, average daily traffic. So in this, what we do is, we just do a survey for say a month or 6 months or 3 days or so. Okay. Minimum it is 3 day, and max to max you can do it for a month or a season. A season, as in India, we have summers, winters, and monsoon. So three months or four month season, if you consider. So if you can do it for that season, or you can decide the season on the type of the adjoining land usage. As in, if your road, it is passing through a village area, okay, or if your highway is passing through a village area, and the in the vicinity, that highway is mainly used by the farmers for their day-to-day commute, or during the harvest season, and so on. So you will plan your survey according to the agricultural season. Okay. So whenever they sow the seeds, they have the period of growth, and then they harvest it, and then they transport it. So that season you will match it for your traffic volume count. Or if it's an industrial area through which your highway is passing, and that is used mainly by those industries, so you'll match your traffic count along with their season. Okay. So that can be the definition of a season in this case. Okay. Or you can do it for 6 months. But We don't do it for 6 months or even a season. In ADT, what we do is we maximum do it for a month and minimum we do it for 3 days. So the procedure is same. You install a suppose video camera and then you do this traffic volume count for suppose a month, and that is 24 hours. There is no relaxation in the hourly calculation. You have to do it for 24 hours. And then you, whatever value you get of number of vehicles passing, you just divide it by 24. So you divide it by the number of days. So if you are doing it for 3 days, you divide it by three. If you are doing it for 7 days, you divide it by seven. A month, you divide it by 30. And then you will get a traffic count, which will be the average daily traffic, that is ADT. Now here I told you that we do this survey mainly by videography, because videography, when you record that video and then you analyze it, it is tedious to analyze, but the accuracy is more. The very primitive method, or even the method which is used in most of the parts of India nowadays also, it is the manual count. That is, you deploy some people on the side of the road and they have a paper and a pen and a standard table, and they go on counting the vehicles, okay, for whatever is the duration. So that is more tedious and more cumbersome. So instead of that, we can go for this videographic survey. But still, in many parts of India and for many projects, this manual count is done till date. So this is the two types of volume measurements that you can have, that is AADT and ADT. Then there is something called 30 hourly traffic volume. Okay. Now I'll just write this value. I'll need it afterwards. So in a year you have 8,760 hours. So coming back to this design hourly traffic volume. Now, if you go by the definition, I am definitely sure that many of you will not able to understand what it is. So 30th, just I'll read it. 30th highest hourly volume. It is also known as design hourly volume. Is the hourly volume that will be reached only 30 times or exceeded only 29 times in a year, and all the other hourly volumes of the year will be less than this value. Okay. If you have understood just by reading this definition, then it's very good. But I'll assume that this definition is a bit tedious and this concept is a bit tedious. And if you go on internet and you go on searching, you'll get a lot of videos explaining what is this design hourly traffic. They also call it DHV, design hourly traffic, or design hourly volume. And you have a typical graph which has such kind of curve, and then they have something over here, and then they get the 30th hourly volume. So I'll not go by the graph because each explanation is a different kind, each one has a different perspective. So I'll just go by a simple understanding that now I have told you that how you can measure the volume or flow. Okay. So now again, assume that we have done this survey. We have counted the number of vehicles for 8,760 hours. That is, we have done a survey for one complete year, 365 days, 24 hours. Okay. And then we have 8,760 values of hourly traffic. That is, if I first hour, second hour. So if I started the survey in on 1st January 2021, suppose now it's almost end of 2020. So if I started the survey on 1st January 2021 and I started it at 12 midnight, so that will be my first hour, then 12 midnight to 1 a.m. second. So like this, I have counted every hour traffic for a complete year. So I will be having 8,760 values. Okay. Of these values will be of hourly traffic. Okay. Or hourly volume. Now what I'll do is I'll arrange these values in descending order. So I'll keep the notation as it is 1, 2, 3, 4 because that is my hours that I am representing. 8760, and I'll just arrange the values which are there. So for first hour, second hour, whatever was their value, I'll just go on arranging in descending order, as in the maximum value will be, suppose in for a particular role you have say in 1 hour 500 vehicles passing. Okay, so this will be 500 vehicles per hour. So I'll arrange it in such a way that the maximum comes on the top and then the values go on decreasing. Okay. So suppose 461, then 320, or like this, whatever are the values that I'll go on writing. Okay. And whatever is the value for 30th hour, okay, so that will be my value of 30th. Design hourly volume. Okay, so this is the most simple explanation that you'll find anywhere about this term, that is 30th highest hourly traffic volume. Okay, now as I told you, you'll find the standard graph also. From that graph, it's very difficult to interpret what actually they want to say. The most simple explanation of this DHV is this one. You just arrange your hourly count for a whole year in descending order, and whatever is the value for 30th hour, so you take it as a 30th DHV. Okay. Now why we are doing all this exercise? So if I ask you that you have to design a road, okay, and you have to decide what will be the width of the road, okay, or if you have to decide whether it will be a 2-lane or a 3-lane or a 4-lane road. Okay. So if I ask you what will be the parameter on which you will decide this number of lanes, so obviously the first thing that should or that will come to your mind definitely is the traffic volume, that how many number of vehicles are expected to pass on that road. Okay. So obviously if you get that quantity or that value, then it will be easy for you to decide whether I will go for a 2-lane or a 3-lane or a 4-lane or a 10-lane even. Okay. So that flow value or the traffic volume value, that will play a major role in this. Okay. Flow or volume value, I'll say. But now again, as you see here, if I have done the survey for the whole year or 8760 hours, so which value should I consider for design? Should I consider this highest value? Okay. So if I ask you whether you will design the road for the highest value or you design the road for the lowest value, or as every time or almost in many cases what you do is you take an average. So out of these three, highest, lowest and average, for which traffic flow you will design that road? You can type your answers in the chat box. For which flow value, the highest, the lowest or the average, for which value you will actually design the road? Only you have to select only for from these. Okay, don't tell me the answer as 30. Okay, there are 33 participants, so I'm expecting 33 answers. Okay, also we're saying highest. Renuka is saying highest. Okay. Rest of you, 33 people, 33 answers. Okay. Just to make sure that sakai 9 vasta tumhala jaga kele shanivari, so you are not in sleep and you have not just started the lecture and kept it somewhere. Okay. Pratiksha is saying highest. Swapnil, average. Saurabh, average. Nyaneshwar, average. Vedantika, average. Vaibhav, average. Vaibhav is saying highest. Aishwarya, average. Okay. Rest of you, 33 people can have 33 answers. Maybe even all the answers are same. Maybe all are saying average or all are saying highest. Okay. Average. Okay. Okay. Madhubala, Shoaib, Rutuja, Pooja, Ashish, They are seeing average. Samiksha is seeing highest. Okay. So now we'll come back to our discussion. Now, what will happen for those who said that we have to design our road for highest? Okay. So now see the highest value. I'll write the lowest value as well. Lowest value is suppose 2 vehicles per hour. Okay. So if I design my road for highest, that is 500 vehicles per hour. So you have the data in front of you for that particular road. You can see that every hour for whole year, how is the variation? So that 500 vehicles per hour, that is the hourly volume, or that is the volume which is there on your, or expected on your road only for 1 hour. So out of 8,760 hours of a year, only for 1 hour, that much traffic is going to come on your, or that is, that much traffic flow is expected on your road, that is 500 vehicles. Okay. So if you design it, suppose from that calculation, you need a 4-lane highway, okay, 4-lane divided highway, suppose 4-lane on this left side and 4-lane on right side, okay, 4-lane for up direction and 4-lane for down direction. Okay. We assume that that is the lane configuration you need for 500 vehicles per hour. So now tell me, when you construct this such huge facility, 8-lane road, and then only for 1 hour, that road will look like it's filled with vehicles. But for the rest of the 8,759 hours of the year, that road will not have that much traffic. So it becomes uneconomical for building such a huge facility only for that traffic volume, which is going to be, or which is expected for just 1 hour, just for 60 minutes, you are building an 8-lane facility. So obviously, if you build it for highest value, it becomes uneconomical. Okay. Now let's talk about the lowest value. If you design it for the lowest value is, you can see the last value, 2 vehicles per hour. Okay. It might be the hourly volume for a particular day in the extreme night time, that is 12 midnight to 1 a.m. Okay. Madhya Ratri Madhya, what we say. So at that time, suppose no vehicle is passing and just 2 vehicles have passed on your road, or are expected to pass on your road. Okay. So if you ask yourself also that only 2 vehicles per hour, so first of all, you will say that why we have to build a road for 2 vehicles per hour. Okay. That's obvious answer. I'll also say that same thing. But suppose if I tell you that no, you have to give some road, so obviously you will give just 1 lane. Okay. Even if those 2 vehicles, one is coming in one is going in up direction and another in down direction, then to one lane will be sufficient. Okay. But now if you see the other values, okay, same 8,759 other values other than this lowest one. So obviously this 1 lane is not going to be sufficient at all. Okay. So in this case, we are neglecting the flow aspect and we are under designing it. Okay. And now let's come to the third one, that is the average. Most of you have said this, that you will design the road for average flow value, okay, or average number of vehicles passing per hour. Now, what will be this average value? Okay. Suppose I did this count for 2019. Okay. Now, we'll come to the actual scenario. You all have gone through 2019 year. You know how was the scenario of traffic everywhere. Okay. But we'll assume that you stayed in Pune and you know the traffic scenario for Pune. So 2019, you have some average value, say suppose 200 vehicles per hour. Okay. Now in 2020, again, you have lived this scenario as well. So you have seen a maximum lockdown period for 6 months and so, and the drastic decrease in number of vehicles on the road, because obviously there was curfew in most of the parts of the country. So the average has decreased to suppose 50 vehicles per hour. Okay. Now again in 2021, suppose we are hopeful that there is a vaccine for this virus, and then we all get back to normal. And if anybody of you is reading newspaper or following the trends, so the number of sales of four-wheelers, it has started increasing drastically because everyone has become paranoid that, okay, if we go in a flock or if we go in a crowd, we are susceptible to that virus and we may encounter it. So instead of that, why not sit in your own vehicle, shut all the doors and windows, and then travel? Okay. So that has seen a tremendous increase in your vehicle population just after the first lockdown or the second lockdown was lifted. So now suppose the average number of vehicles has become 300. So what I'm trying to say is every year your average value will go on fluctuating. It will depend on n number of reasons. It might be some political reason, it might be some this pandemic kind of situation, it might be something like this, that suppose that highway was going through an agriculture area, but now suddenly there is a drought, okay, Dushkar Padla, and then for a year there is no agricultural produce, everything or that area has been declared as a barren land, and the people also living there have shifted to some another village or town. So in that case, there will be no vehicles using your road. It may happen. I'm just considering the worst case scenario. So if you take average, that will also go on fluctuating. So every year you can't change that road, na? You can't do like this. Okay, in 2019 we'll keep it two-lane highway. In 2020, there are less number of vehicles, so we'll just cut down the two lanes and we'll go back to one lane. And then again in 2021, we'll increase one lane. Okay. So that is obviously illogical and not possible also. So that average value also, even if many of our times we do take this average value, okay, but it's not correct from the design perspective. Okay. So what is the solution? So they came up with a solution that let's go for this kind of a study, that 365 day, 8,760 hours, we'll do a traffic survey, we'll see what is the trend, and then by plotting a graph, then we'll see that actually what happens. So then they plotted a graph. I'll not go into the details of it, but they found some kind of a trend like this. So you all have studied that much basic mathematics, that whenever you have a graph, you have a curve, so that curve has some equation. Okay. And that equation, so if I divide this curve in two parts, basically this part is you see a drastic decrease, and then the decline has become almost steady. So they observed that for most of the cases, for many roads, they did this exercise for a lot of roads. And then they came up to that, okay, for almost all roads, the value or this fluctuation or this curve, it goes on becoming, or you get two peculiar equations from each of the curve. So that equations or that breakdown, you can say it happens at 30th hour. So that's why this 30th design hourly volume came into picture. And obviously, when this term was coined, it was way back in the 60s or 70s, I guess. So that time the traffic scenario was different. So we can't still follow the same trend, that we can't take the 30th hourly volume. So this totally depends on what is the type of road. It may be a urban road, it may be a rural road, it may be expressway. Through what area that road is going, what is the demand over there? So based on that, this design hourly traffic value, it will change. Okay, so whether to take 30th or to take the 40th or to take the 10th, so this will totally depend on the site situation. So this is the discussion about the design hourly volume, okay, or DHV. So there is a lot of thing that can go, or we can go into detail in this. We have a seasonal correction factor, we have a directional factor, and all that kind of thing. So I'll not go into that details over here, just to give you an idea to before finishing this topic. So there is something called AADT, And we have seen that it is almost not possible to do the survey and find out the ADT value. So we do the ADT, or we find out the ADT value, because that is possible to do a survey for 7 days or 3 days or a month or so, and then to come up with the ADT value. But there has to be some correlation between this AADT and ADT. Okay, obviously, because we are saying that we will not do AADT, or will not find out AADT directly, but we'll find ADT. So in that case, you have to multiply this ADT by some factors, and those factors can be like this. So AADT, it can be written as ADT into DF into WF into SF. DF is the daily factor. Okay. I mean, 24 hours also, if you just observe a road, yeah, or suppose your home is on a nearby a highway, and you can see that highway very clearly. So just even if you observe it now also, that now it's suppose around 9:30. You go and observe it at 10 a.m. Then you observe it at 11 a.m., 12 noon, 1. Okay, like that, up each hour. So you will find that every hour there is not a same traffic. Every hour the traffic goes on changing. Okay, so that means within a day itself there is an hourly variation. Okay, so you have to take care of that hourly variation. Okay. Similarly, there is a daily variation also. So suppose today is Saturday, so Saturday there might be less traffic. Sunday, it's a holiday, so even less traffic. Monday, it's working day, so people are going to office, so the traffic increases. So likewise, you have a daily variation also. This DF, it will take care of the daily variation. Likewise, there will be a weekly variation also. Okay? It might be possible. There will be a seasonal variation as well. So seasonal variation, as I told you one example, that your highway is going through a rural road. Yeah. So though it's a highway, the vicinity, everywhere there are villages. The predominantly people are doing agriculture as their occupation. So there, according to season, the traffic might vary. So in the harvest season, when once the crops are ready to be cut, so and after harvesting, they are taken to the nearby market, or it is sent to some factory for processing. So in that case, the traffic will increase, number of trucks will increase in that case. Okay. So if any one of you is from the rural background, who has a agriculture background, so you might be knowing this. Okay. Whenever you have a sugarcane harvest or you have a rice harvest, so there is the number of trucks or tractors in case of India, that goes on increasing in that much period. So that's the seasonal variation that you can have. So all these variation you have to take into account. You have to allot some factors to it, and then you have to multiply it to the annual or average daily traffic, and then you will get the AADT value. For designing purpose or for taking the decisions, always you need this AADT value. Okay. So somehow you have to arrive at this AADT value. So this I'll not go into detail now into this, because it will be a lot of time consuming, and it's not desirable in the syllabus also that you go into this much detail. You will get to know this if any of you goes into that field and goes on doing the traffic survey. So you yourself will find out what is this daily factor and weekly factor and seasonal factor. Okay. So just remember for now this equation AADT is equal to ADT into all these factors. Okay. Now the next topic that I would like to discuss is the passenger car unit. Okay. Might be some of you might have heard this, or you are hearing it for the first time today. So passenger car unit, before going to the actual definition, I'll again present some scenarios in front of you. Okay. So first scenario, you have two-lane road, okay, and both the lanes are for same direction traffic. Okay. I've not given up and down direction, same direction traffic. Okay, so in scenario one, on the road, on this road, I have 10 vehicles, okay, and predominantly all the vehicles are cars. Okay. So now just now assume or visualize that there is a road, it's a two-lane road. You have 10 vehicles on it, and all 10 vehicles are cars. Okay. And you are suppose on a two-wheeler and you are passing through this stretch. So this, as I told you in the starting of this unit, that every traffic stream has its own characteristics. Okay. So this stream of 10 vehicles, it will be having its own characteristics, that there will be some flow value, there will be some density value. There will be some speed for it, average speed you can find out. So this is the first scenario. Now in the second scenario, the same road. Now what I have done is I have just banned all the cars from entering that stretch, and I have only allowed the trucks. Okay. So now this is the scenario. The road is same. The time interval is also same. Suppose I have done this for morning 9 to 10. But obviously, I have selected only a particular vehicles to enter this stretch. So from morning 9 to 10 on a particular road stretch, I have allowed 10 cars first. Then the next day, I have allowed only the trucks. Okay, that too, 10 trucks. So scenario one, there are 10 vehicles. In scenario two, also there are 10 vehicles. But the difference is, in first scenario, all the vehicles were cars. In second scenario, all the vehicles are trucks. So obviously now I tell you to talk about this traffic stream in the scenario two. So obviously you'll say that 10 trucks are there in this much stretch. So obviously the speed of that stream will be less because all our trucks are all are heavily loaded. So might be they are going a bit slow as compared to the cars. And also the spacing between them is quite less because you can't really find out a way in between this trucks. Okay. If you are there on a bike, might be you can maneuver or you can move through these cars, but you can't move through the trucks. Okay. So that is the second scenario. In third scenario, now same road stretch. Now instead of cars or two trucks, I have taken two-wheelers. All 10 vehicles are two-wheelers. Okay. So obviously two-wheelers, they are having their own speed. They are having much less size as compared to your cars or trucks. So obviously the stream will be a fast moving stream. Unless and until there is some breakdown over here. But if only 10 two-wheelers are passing, so this stream will, or this two 10 two-wheelers will pass from the stretch in a pretty in a less time. So this is the third scenario. And in the fourth scenario, now what I have done is I have mixed all three. Same, there are 10 vehicles, but now it's combination of two-wheelers, cars, and truck. Okay, it's not a fixed proportion. I have just randomly distributed it. Now here the scenario will be different. So now what I'm trying to, or where I'm trying to take you is, in scenario one, two, three, and four, all the four scenarios, the road stretch was same. We had taken the same road. The only thing that we varied is the type of vehicle. Even the number of vehicles we kept the same. The road stretch was same. The number of vehicles was same. In all scenarios, we have taken only 10 vehicles. But what we have varied is the type of vehicle. In first, we took only cars. In second, only trucks. In third, only two-wheelers. And now, in the fourth one, we have taken all three. So obviously, there will be a difference if I just say, if I would have not shown you this of pictorial representation of cars and vehicles and roads, and if I had just told you that there are four scenarios of for a particular road, and on in all four scenarios you have 10 vehicles on your road. And if I ask you what how much time it will take for you to pass through all these 10 vehicles, so you'll say it will be the same because I have just told you that you have 10 vehicles and I have not shown you the picture. But now the moment I introduce that, no, in scenario number one, you have all 10 cars. In scenario two, you have all 10 trucks. In three, you have all 10 two-wheelers. And in four, you have a mixed one. Now, if I ask you how much time it will take to pass through this traffic, now you'll go on analyzing a bit that, okay, if it's cars, I'll need this much time. If it's only trucks, I'll take a lot more time because I have to follow the slow moving truck and I have to wait for the gap to open up. Okay? If it's a two wheeler, you can just pass on very quickly. If it's a mixed, again, it will take some time. So you see, what you did was you decided that time based on what parameter, that what is the type of vehicle in your stream. And basically, type of vehicle means you thought of what is the dimension of that vehicle and what is the speed of that vehicle. Okay. So the moment I tell it's a heavy loaded truck, so it comes to your mind that heavy loaded truck, okay, it will be of a huge size, it will be slow moving. Okay. If I tell you it's a two wheeler, you will say, okay, it's a small size, it will go quickly, speed will be more. So what happens is, in case of mixed traffic condition, what we have in India and almost in many parts of the world, if you concentrate only on India, suppose. So in India, on the roads, you take any road, you take urban road, you take rural road, you take highway, expressway, you have a mixed type of traffic. Now, there in these scenarios, I showed you only four types. That is cars, two wheelers, trucks, and the mixed traffic condition. So I only gave three types of vehicles, okay? Cars, four wheelers, and sorry, cars, trucks, and two wheelers. But in actual site, if you see on the roads, there are almost 15 to 16 types of vehicles. Okay? So even in those, we include the cycles, we include the animal drawn vehicle, whatever are the bullock carts or horse driven carts are there, we consider that. We consider the tractors. So all these different types of vehicles are also considered. So it comes out to be 15 to 16 types of vehicles which are there on Indian roads at present. Okay. So obviously, the behavior of this traffic stream will be different. So it will be very difficult if I just give you such values that you have 100 vehicles per hour. Okay. And if I don't give you the picture, and if I just give you the value that you have 100 vehicles per hour, and now you have to design the road. So maybe you will say that, okay, 100 vehicles per hour, it comes out to be two lane. But if I tell you that those hundreds are trucks, then you will think that, okay, if it's a truck and if I give two lane, so might be it will be sufficient. But if another vehicle has to enter it, so it will not find that much gap in between. Okay. So what I'm saying is, this vehicle per hour, or only justifying your flow value by this vehicle, it is somewhat difficult from a designer point of view. So you need to express it in some standard form so that it will be understood very well. So for that, we have this concept of PCU, that is passenger car unit. So what is done in this is, a factor is allotted to each type of vehicle. Okay. So as I told you, you have cars, you have two wheelers, you have animal drawn vehicles, you have cycles and all that. So for each vehicle, you have some factor which is associated. Okay. And then if you have to calculate the flow, you have to do what you have to do is, you have to multiply the number of vehicles by that factor. Okay. And then whatever value you get, you will get it in PCU per hour. So let me give you an example. So for rural roads, okay, the roads which are, or the highways that we say, so as per the standard Indian Road Congress Code of or IRC 64, you have these values. So if you see now, motorcycle or scooter, that is the two wheeler, you have a factor of 0.5. A passenger car, okay, or a pickup van or auto rickshaw, its factor is 1. A tractor, factor is 1.5. Truck or bus, it is factor is 3. Truck trailer or agricultural tractors, 4.5. So now these, they have mentioned in the category of fast moving vehicles. And if you see the slow moving vehicles, again, the cycle, it's 0.5, cycle rickshaw 2, and the most highest in this is the bullock cart. So it has a factor of 8. So these are the PCU values. The factor is nothing but these are your PCU PCU values. Now, if you observe, what they have done is they have allotted a higher, or they have allotted a high PCU value to those vehicles which are big in size, okay, whose dimensions are more, and also whose speed is less. So bullock cart, you know, it is having very less speed, plus it is having more size as compared to a standard passenger car, if you say. Okay. So it is having a PCU value of 8. Similarly, a truck trailer or agriculture tractor, it is having a PCU value of 4.5, because size wise it's more, and maybe speed wise it is speedy, it's having more speed than a bullock cart, but definitely it is having less speed than your passenger car. So passenger car, they have kept the PCU value as 1, because that is considered as a standard one. And then with respect to this passenger car, all the other types of vehicles are evaluated, and then this PCU value is obtained. So if I say that for a particular road, suppose I have in a 1 hour time interval, I have 10 two-wheelers passing, 20 cars, okay, one agriculture tractor, 2 buses, one truck trailer, okay, 2 cycles, 1 cycle rickshaw, suppose 0 hand cart, 0 animal drawn, and 2 bullock carts. So if I add it up, so it's 10, you can just add it up, 10, 20, 30, 34, 34 and 337, 39. So this will be 39 vehicles per hour. I hope my addition is correct. So now again, the same question. If I tell you that you have a traffic volume of 39 vehicles per hour, you might not get a clear picture. But if I tell you, now if I convert it, that 10 into 2.5, this will be 20, this will be 1.5, 6, 4.5, 1, 2, 0, 0, 16. Okay. If you add all of them, just one of you can do the addition. I'll also do quickly on my side. It's 16. Okay. So the value comes out to be 56 PCU per hour. Now you will be in a position to understand that, okay, it's 56 PCU per hour. It might seem a bit odd this time because you have dealt with this PCU term for the first time right now. But once you go into the field, you go on designing things and you go on finding the traffic in this PCU, then you will get an idea that, okay, 56 PCU means what? And in that also, you will be having this split up. You will be knowing that what is the individual percentage or individual count of each type of vehicle. So you will come to know that actually what is the need for that road. Okay, you have to design it for predominantly trucks, or predominantly for cycles, or predominantly for cars. Okay, so that's the use of your PCU value. And then again, if you come back to this theory part, so this is the same what I have explained, you know. And the main thing is this, that PCU, it is a function of how they decided that PCU value. They decided it on the basis of what is the dimension of that vehicle and what is the speed of that vehicle. Okay. So in urban scenario, the speed differential among different vehicle is low. That is, in urban scenario, almost all the vehicles are traveling more or less at the same speed. Okay. So 40 to, if the maximum speed is 40, so maybe two-wheelers are traveling at a 40 kmph, four-wheelers are traveling at a bit less, 35 or so. But it's more or less same. Okay. So hence, PCU is or PCU value in this urban scenario, it is predominantly the function of physical dimension of vehicle, okay, rather than the speed one. But even nevertheless, these two are the deciding criteria for a PCU value. So as I showed you for the rural roads, similarly, IRC has given the values for urban roads as well. Only difference is they have categorized it based on the flow value, that the composition, percentage composition, that out of 100 vehicles, suppose the composition of only two-wheeler is 5% or less than or more than 5%, so you have to adopt these values. And if the composition is 10% or above for that particular category, so you have to consider this second column of values. So this is with the discussion about PCU. Then if I now we will move on to speed values. Okay, now you all know what is a speed. It's for a particular, suppose 1 kilometer, you need 10 minutes to travel that 1 kilometer. So you'll just, what you'll do is you'll divide the 1 kilometer by 10 minutes. Okay, and you will convert it to kmph and you get some speed. Well, that is the basic one. But from traffic engineering point of view, there are 5 different types of the speeds as well. Okay, so the first one is the spot speed. So it is the instantaneous speed. Now many of you must have heard this, that nowadays in many cities they have installed some speed detectors, or on many highways they have installed this speed detectors which calculates the speed and they know whether you are over speeding or not, and according to that you get a traffic challan that okay, you have violated the speed limit and this is the fine that you have to pay. So what they do is, in that case, they have a speed gun installed at the side of the road. Okay, so suppose this is the road, I'm showing you the top view, and here that gun is installed. So what it will do is, whenever you cross this line, okay, so this line is not actually seen, it's a laser gun sort of thing, and that laser is also not visible. Okay, so it works on different kinds of or different wavelength. I'll not go into that technicality, but just to make you aware that that is the kind of thing or working principle. So whenever a vehicle passes, based on the wavelength, the difference in the wavelength of the returning of that wave, they can know that what is the speed. So if you are doing this kind of a study or finding this kind of a speed, that at a particular point for a particular time, what is the speed of that vehicle? So that is nothing but your spot speed. Okay, so it's, I have written the instantaneous speed. Instantaneous is at that particular location at that particular moment. Okay, so that's the spot speed. The second is the running speed. Now running speed, it is nothing but if you go from suppose A to B, okay, and for understanding purpose we'll give it a name that A is nothing but your college and B is, suppose we'll consider, what should I consider, we'll consider AUND. Okay, so you have to follow the AUND Ravik road. Suppose, so when I go from A to B, I'll start my vehicle at A, and in between obviously it's not a straightforward road, you have a lot of curves, you have gradients, you have traffic signals. Okay, maybe there is a traffic congestion at some point. Okay, so in that case, for whatever duration your vehicle is in motion, okay, so that will be your running speed. Okay, from the name itself you can get some hint that running speed is for whatever duration your vehicle was in motion, you find out the that time, suppose. Okay, so if PCCA to AUND, I guess we'll take it arbitrarily some value, suppose it's 10 kilometer. So for this 10 kilometer, suppose you needed or you took 30 minutes. Okay, so in this 30 minutes, for actually how much duration your vehicle was actually moving, so maybe it was in motion for 26 minutes. Okay, and the rest of the 4 minutes it was on a standstill. Maybe you had to stop for a traffic signal or there was a traffic congestion, so you had to stop for a few minutes or seconds over there. So in that way we calculate that how much was the time for which the vehicle was actually running. So it was running for 26 minutes, and then what we'll do is, as we do for a speed is nothing but distance upon time. So you divide 10 kilometer by 26 minutes, convert it into kmph, whatever you get, that will be the running speed. Okay, and what will be the journey speed? Journey speed will be nothing but it will be 10 kilometer divided by this 30 minutes. So in journey speed, what you include is the delay as well, but in running speed, you only consider the time when your vehicle was in motion. So that's the main difference in these two, running speed and journey speed. Running speed, when vehicle was in motion, and journey speed, it is including all the stopping also. Okay. So these are the first three types. The next two types, they are more or less similar to each other. That is, one is time mean speed and second is space mean speed. So time mean speed is nothing but it's an average speed, and the average is taken from the point of view that if you read the definition, it is defined as average speed of all vehicles passing on a highway over a specified time period. Okay. So suppose I consider 15 minutes. So in 15 minutes, I'll have the value. I will consider an example. So in 15 minutes, suppose 50 vehicles have passed from a particular point. Okay, and you were there with the speed gun in your hand, and you have taken the readings of all this 50 speed values. Okay, so 50 vehicles, you have got 50 speed values. Okay. And now, if I ask you to make the average of it, okay, so whatever average you get, that will be the time mean speed, TMS. Okay. And SMS or space mean speed, it is nothing but it is also the average speed, but now what we have introduced is we are finding out that average speed of all vehicles occupying a given section of a highway over some period of time. Now again, we'll consider 50 vehicles, you have 50 speed values, and you have done this survey for 15 minutes, but now we have done this survey for only for a 100 meter stretch. So in TMS, what we had done, time mean speed, you had considered a particular point, but now in space mean speed, you are considering a particular length. Okay. So in this 100 meter, for this 15 minutes, how many vehicles passed? So 50 vehicles passed, and what was their speed? So if you take the average of this, now that will be known as the space mean speed. Now obviously there will be a difference, because time mean speed, you are saying that you are finding out the instantaneous speed, or you are doing it for a particular point, okay, for 15 minutes. But in space mean speed, you have to consider the whole stretch, okay, whatever is it, it is 100 meter or 1 kilometer or anything. So that's the difference between time mean speed and space mean speed. Okay. And in speed itself, there is one more thing. Now, many of the times you must have seen some signages that you have a such sign that you have a red circle kind of thing, okay, and in that it is written 80, suppose. So this 80, what is this 80 actually? So this 80 defines the speed limit. Okay. So for every road, there is something called a design speed and there is something called a speed limit. But actually, how we arrive at these values? Okay. So how we'll know that speed limit should be kept 80? So what we do is, we do a speed survey for a particular road. Suppose you have constructed a new road, okay, and then just after opening, in within 1 week, you do this speed survey, and what you do is you find out the spot speed values, okay, spot speed or instantaneous speed values. You find it for randomly for the vehicles, okay, and you note down the readings, and then you find out the cumulative frequency. Okay. Now, cumulative frequency, how to calculate it? You all know, you have used it many a times. Okay. You categorize these speeds. Okay. 10, 20, 30, 40. You find out which vehicle was in which category, and then you find out the number, and then you find out the cumulative, and then you convert it to frequency. Okay. So that thing I'll not go into detail. So you find out the cumulative frequency, and then you plot a graph on y-axis, the frequency, and on x-axis the speed. Or, and mainly, most of the times you get this kind of graph. This is also known as an S-curve for speed, okay, because it's in shape of a S, so that's why. Okay. So more or less, it is observed that you get this kind of a curve. Not exactly you will get this kind of curve, but the trend is sort of an S-curve. So after this, Now, if you find out these values, 85th percentile and 98th percentile. So what I'll do is I'll just drop a horizontal line up to the curve and then I'll drop a vertical line. So 85th percentile, whatever speed you get, so here it is, you are getting approximately 55 kmph. Okay. So this 85th percentile, it will be your speed limit. Okay. And whatever is the 90th percentile, so it comes out to be, suppose, 78. Okay. So this 78 kmph, this will be your design speed. Okay. So as a designer, you will design this highway for 78, or even you can round it up to 80, suppose. Okay. They'll round it up to 80. So you have to design this highway for 80 kmph. That means whatever geometrics that you have studied in the previous unit, so in every geometric, even every part of the geometric, you had this variable of speed, okay, design speed. So there, everywhere you will take 80 kmph. But when you install a speed limit sign, then you will install it for 55 kmph just because you have to avoid the overspeeding. So if you, now even on the highways, I don't know how many of you might have followed this. If you see a speed limit sign, and if you just check your actual speed on the speedometer, it never happens that the speed limit is more and you are going with a very slow speed. Mainly it happens that you are traveling at a faster speed. So that's why that speed limit sign is installed, so that there is no overspeeding and then everyone travels safely, because it's not only you who is traveling on that road. Along with you, there are a lot of people. There are a lot of people with different types of behavior, different types of vehicles. And then it is not possible for all of them to travel at the same speed of 80 kmph. So that's why we take the speed limit a lower value. Okay. So in this way, we decide the speed limit for a particular road. Okay. So next time, whenever you travel on any type of a road, and if you happen to come across a speed limit sign, so just see the type of road, see the lane configuration, see the speed limit, okay, and observe the traffic in general. Okay, so that will give you a clear sense of why the speed limit is installed or why this value has been taken. Okay. Then another small concept in traffic engineering is something called headway. Okay. Now again, headway, if I just tell you this term, it is totally new to you, but if I want to give you an example, so again, if I consider a road and now I consider two vehicles, only two vehicles I am considering for understanding purpose. And these two vehicles, they are traveling at their own speed. Suppose both are having a constant speed. Suppose one is traveling at V1, another is traveling at V2, and that speed is, they are maintaining that speed. So whatever is the bumper to bumper distance, okay, front to front or rear to rear, or even in some cases the clear distance, okay, but main thing is the distance. So whatever is this distance, this is known as the space headway or distance headway. Okay. So again, I've written the definition, you can read it. It's the distance between corresponding points of two successive vehicles, okay, at any given point of time. Okay. And it may be rear to rear or front to front or clear distance between them. So this is nothing but the, or this is known as the space headway or distance headway. Okay. Now for the same road, okay, and for the same vehicles, now the vehicles have traveled here somewhere. And what I will do is I'll assume a reference line. Okay. I'll stand here with a stopwatch in my hand. Okay. And whenever this first vehicle, it crosses or its front reaches here, suppose, I'll start my stopwatch from zero, okay, and I'll let the vehicle pass. And then the second vehicle, whenever it will reach this same reference line, I'll stop the stopwatch, and suppose that time was 5 seconds. Okay. So this will be my time headway. So time headway is nothing but the time difference between two successive vehicles passing a given point. Okay. And again, that given point should be fixed, and the vehicle or which part of the vehicle you are considering, that should be also fixed. So if you are considering only the front part, you have to consider that front part or front bumper of all the vehicles. If you are considering the rear, you have to consider rear for all. Okay. You have to keep that uniformity. So that's the concept of headway, that the space headway, that is nothing but the distance between two successive vehicles, either rear to rear or front to front bumper. And time headway is nothing but the distance or time difference between the two vehicles passing a given point, that is nothing but the time headway. Okay. Now, when I started this traffic engineering, I had introduced two terms to you. One was the macroscopic characteristic of a traffic stream, and another was a microscopic. Okay. And I had told you that macroscopic is nothing but when you consider a stream as a whole, so then you consider it as a macroscopic characteristic. Okay. But if you consider a single entity in that stream, okay, either a pedestrian, either a cycle or a vehicle or a car or a truck, so if you find the characteristics of that particular vehicle, then it becomes microscopic. Okay. So whenever you want to define a stream by its macroscopic characteristics, what you need is the flow value, you need the speed value, and you need the density value. So speed, flow, and density, they are considered as a macroscopic characteristics. Now speed, obviously you can have speed for individual vehicle also. So and that will also be a microscopic characteristic in some cases, but mostly it is coming under the macroscopic characteristics. And microscopic, the headway that we have seen just now, so headway, it comes under the microscopic characteristics of a traffic stream. Okay, because you are going into detail and you are finding out the gap between the two vehicles or the time difference between the two vehicles. So we are going at the micro level for analyzing the characteristics for a particular vehicle. So this is something that you should remember, that headway, it comes under microscopic, and flow, speed, and density, it comes under macroscopic characteristics of a traffic stream. Okay. And the last topic for today that I'll cover is highway capacity. So highway capacity, now I had asked you this question in when we are discussing design early volume, that for how much volume you will design your road. Okay. So if it is 500 vehicles per hour, so how much lanes you will provide. Okay. So ideally, whenever you construct a road, suppose I am taking a two-lane road, so that two-lane road, it will have its own capacity. Okay, that how much vehicle it can accommodate. Now obviously that will depend on what are the type of vehicle, because we have just now seen in PCU that as the types of vehicle change, its dimensions change. So mainly what we are trying is, in this road stretch, suppose this is a 1 kilometer stretch I have considered, 1 kilometer stretch of a two lane road, and both the lanes are for this single direction traffic. So how much vehicles your road can accommodate in this 1 kilometer stretch, that is nothing but capacity of your road. Okay. Not only 1 kilometer, I have taken 1 kilometer as arbitrary value, but it is in general that how much vehicles your highway can accommodate. Okay. Now this can be per kilometer, this can be per lane, this can be per hour also. So generally the capacity is, it is expressed as vehicle per hour per lane. Okay. So in a particular lane, in one particular hour, how much vehicles can accommodate on your highway or pass through your highway, that is nothing but the capacity value. In general, capacity definition is this, that it is the ability of the road or the traffic lane to allow maximum traffic flow or traffic volume per unit time. So that's why you have got this unit, that it's generally vehicle per hour. Vehicle per hour, you know, it's unit of traffic flow or volume, but vehicle per hour per lane, okay, or per kilometer. Okay. So generally per kilometer is not preferred because it becomes a very a difficult kind of thing to analyze. So per lane you can take, and that becomes your capacity of the road. Now, whenever we say that there is a traffic congestion, or in layman term, many of you say that there is a traffic jam over here. Okay. So try to adopt this terminology that now you are a transportation acquainted engineer. So instead of traffic jam, better say traffic congestion, okay, in technical terms. So whenever we say that there is a traffic congestion, what it means is that the road capacity has reached its maximum, or what, how, whatever is the number of vehicles that this road can accommodate or a lane can accommodate, that has been now reached to its maximum, and now not a single vehicle can be added into it. So in that case, it we say that there is a traffic congestion. Okay. So you see, capacity, it is important to understand or know about this capacity, because it tells you that what is the level of service of your road. Okay. Now this is again something that we'll be seeing in next few lectures, but for now you just remember that there is something called LOS, level of service, and which is nothing but, if I tell you that on a road you are traveling in a car, and there is only, or on an average there are only 2-3 vehicles you will see on that road, and it's a 2-lane road. So obviously you will say that, okay, it's a very good scenario. I am traveling in a car, there are only 2-3 vehicles around me, yeah, and it's a 2-lane road. So it will be a good scenario, and in that case you'll say that the level of service is you are getting a good level of service, and then you can drive your vehicle freely. But now again, in this scenario itself, if I tell you that instead of 2 vehicles, now there are 50 vehicles around you, and then you are traveling with them, then you'll think that, okay, there are 50 vehicles, so now whatever speed you were getting before when there were 2 vehicles around you, now you'll have to reduce your speed. So, and you will also take more time to go from point A to point B. So in that case, the level of service, you will say that, okay, I'm not getting that much service, I'm getting a bit lower one. So in that case, that level of service will drop. So this will go on happening, and once it reaches the maximum, that you are stuck in a traffic congestion, you are just moving inch by inch. So in that case, the road has reached the maximum capacity, and the level of service is the worst one. Okay. So in that case, you need to study this capacity. Okay. I mean, capacity also, you have different types, and basically there are 3 types. First one is the basic capacity, or the theoretical one. So obviously from the theoretical one itself, so it's maximum vehicles per hour under ideal conditions. So ideal conditions, as I told you, that it's a 2-lane road, only 2-3 vehicles are there around you, so that will be an ideal condition for any driver. Okay. So in that condition, how many vehicles can pass through that road? Okay, so that will be the basic capacity, or the theoretical capacity of your road. Then the next thing that I told you, that suppose there are 50 vehicles around you. Okay. So in 50 vehicles, now when you try to find out the capacity, so that will be the possible capacity, that it is the maximum vehicles per hour under, it is the maximum vehicles per hour under prevailing roadway and traffic condition. Now the prevailing condition is that you have 50 vehicles around you, and still it's not like you are at a standstill and you can't travel, you are still driving your four wheeler, and it is possible for you to travel on that road. Okay, so that will be the possible capacity for your road. Okay, so those are the prevailing conditions on that road. So that is the possible capacity, and obviously it is much lower than the basic capacity. Why lower? Because capacity is, it is nothing but, it is a sort of a measure of a flow itself. So it's vehicle per hour itself. Okay. Vehicle per hour per lane, suppose what we had seen. So basically it's a volume measure. So it will be lower, the possible capacity, it will obviously be less than the theoretical capacity. And then comes the practical capacity, or design capacity. So it is the maximum vehicles per hour, again, that can pass a given point, And this is important in case of a practical capacity or design capacity, that it is the maximum vehicles per hour, but what is the condition that you can travel on that road without the traffic density being so high that there is no delay. So even if suppose you consider that 30 vehicles per 30 vehicles are there around you and you are traveling in that traffic stream, but it is more or less a ideal situation for you that you are not frustrated by that 30 vehicles. They are traveling at a pretty decent speed and you are also traveling at a decent speed. You are not not being delayed to your destination. So that's the condition. So in that case, whatever is the capacity, that is known as the practical or design capacity. Okay. So this is important, that without a density going to an such an extent that there is a unreasonable delay or there is a restriction to driver freedom. So in that case, whatever is the condition or prevailing roadway condition, under that condition, whatever is the capacity, that is nothing but the practical capacity or also known as the design capacity. Okay. And how to calculate it? So either you can calculate it by using the space headway, or you can calculate it by the time headway. So it's theoretical definition or theoretical capacity formula. So what we had seen here, the basic capacity or the theoretical capacity. So that capacity QC, it is equal to 1000 into the speed, design speed in kmph upon the average center to center spacing between the vehicle. That is nothing but the space headway. Okay. Now here you see they have considered center to center spacing. Okay. So it's up to you. Either you can consider center to center, front to front, rear to rear, or the clear distance. Okay. So that will give you the maximum capacity for that particular road. Okay. And instead of space headway, suppose you have a time headway, that you have counted that time interval between two successive vehicles passing. So from that, this HT, if you just divide 3600 by HT, and HT is nothing but the minimum time headway in seconds. So minimum time headway means the vehicles are passing at a pretty decent speed and there is no stoppage in between. So that's why the minimum time headway. Okay. And why this 3600? 3600 is nothing but in 1 hour you have 300. In 1 hour you have 3600 seconds. And you are considering your time headway in seconds. So that's why in 1 hour, how much vehicles can pass on your road? So that will give you the capacity again. But now in this case, what you have considered is the time headway instead of space headway. Okay. So this is all regarding the capacity, and we'll stop here for today.